Coming, biggest questions for the AFC North on the show today. And joining us, I'm so excited about this, 13-year NFL veteran, defensive back with the Denver Broncos, Kareem Jackson, Reamboy 25, KJack TV superstar. And right here live in studio, we have comedian and actor who stars on the Apple TV Plus series Loot with my forever girl crush, Maya Rudolph. And Ron Funchess is going to be here. We're very excited about that. He's going to, Eric, sunset flip me into a pile drive? What? He's a big guy, Eric. Ron Funchess. Very funny. He puts the fun in Funchess. Yeah. I wonder if he has a fantasy team. Honey Funchess of Oats. That'd be pretty good. It's not bad. Devin Funchess, that's where I got that from. From way back in the day. I didn't make that up. Not that clever. We all have him on the show. He's got a new summer tour, guys. Fun Voices, Apple TV Plus series Loot to promote. We're going to have fun with him. And I'm sure something will go wrong and be really fun. So enjoy. And we love this. We're going to do a first basket tonight, right? Game two of our series. I'm not really owning the, even though we'll be in New York next week and I'll probably change my mind when I'm there and I'm feeling it. We're a West Coast operation. We are doing the Western Conference Finals. We are doing the Nugs, Chicken Nuggets, if you're asking our guy, Rashad White, the running back for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, up against the Lakers. It's game two tonight. Who scores first? We're all going to make our picks. I'm just going to text Chandler Parsons.
That's not fair.
I don't have his number. Who can text Richard back in the control? Can you just text Chandler, wake him up in Cabo here, and ask him while he's having his huevos rancheros to tell me who's hitting the first basket, because that's what I'm going to go with. We'll get some stuff on Twitter for that going a little bit out later in the show. We also have Preakness.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Preakness is happening this weekend. I'm a little sad we're not there to see if Mage can get something going.
I think he will.
Now, if Mage wins, we're going to the Belmont? Is that the third
baby.
One?
Uh-huh.
To see if the Triple Crown? Things
yes.
can happen. All right, great. Hit us up at Up and Adam Show. Big show. Kareem Jackson is here. Now he's already had time with Russell Wilson. Have to ask him about that. Now he's got Sean Payton as his coach. Sean Payton, did he call him and say, I want you back on the team? Did he think about maybe going back to the Texans where he started his career? He means so much to that organization. It probably means so much to him. We'll get into all of that and what people are thinking about the Broncos. You know, we had Patrick Surtain on the show a couple of weeks ago. So excited to hear what Kareem Jackson has to say. But let's get to the producer's favorite segment because they like to yell and hit me with paper snowballs, even though they don't even have to come up to work on Friday. Woo! You guys don't even have to be on the air on Friday. So you guys should be happy.
This
we should
is the
be.
First one, though.
Yeah. This is what?
This is the first one in a while.
Mirth. such a Gen Z thing. Now, Conrad, when you say that, do people hear it or just me? Because sometimes I feel like you say it and it happens in the whole studio, but that's just in my ear that you're yelling. Conrad. Oh. You know how sometimes when he yells during the segment, it comes off the loudspeaker?
Mm-hmm.
That wasn't that, though.
No.
All right. Well, let us know what you guys think. It's time for everyone's favorite segment, Unanswered Questions. Gronk made waves. Polarizing world. Do you take less if you're a quarterback? Should you play GM? Should you play nice? If you're one of the best quarterbacks in the league to build around your team with this silly little salary cap? That is the big question that we were talking about. And you guys can give us your thoughts in that clip of Gronk saying, yeah, he should pull a Brady, not marry a supermodel, but, you know, take a little less money to build up his roster and contend every year. Let us know at Up and Adam Show, but it's time to hit the AFC North, and Cincinnati is where we kick things off because, whatever, Burrow's deal, it will get done.
There get probably to the question!
Let's go, come on.
The playoff
what are you
or
for?
Drama, here's hoping. Listen, my question for my Bengals is, can this new look defense pick up where last year's version left off? Just a couple months later, can we keep this thing going? Since he lost three quarters of their starting secondary, Jesse Bates signs that big deal down in Atlanta. Von Bell goes to Carolina. Eli Apple's deal expires. He's still on the market, but the Bengals have been preparing for this, okay? And they're betting on their ability to find players in the draft to revamp Lou Anarumo's squad. Over the last two drafts, they've spent all six. Okay, this is crazy. All six of their first second day picks on defensive players, okay? Last year, they took Dax Hill from Michigan as a potential replacement for Jesse Bates. They also added Cam Taylor Britt, who played a big role down the stretch, and defensive lineman Zachary Carter out of Florida. This year, they took Miles Murphy to try to ramp up their pass rush. Dax Hill's college teammate, DJ Turner, and Jordan Battle, who we met. And he's versatile, he's out of Alabama, we like him. So, if the Bengals are gonna make it to a third straight AFC title game, and finally capture that Super Bowl, these young guys are going to have to get up to speed very quickly and make a huge impact this year. And it's so crazy. The third straight AFC Championship. Tough conference. They make it, yet they only have 4 primetime games.
Something's fishy.
What is that? But a little chip on the shoulder. Don't talk about it. The mayor definitely don't talk about it, but just keep that in your heads as you're going through these off-season workouts. Okay, next up, let's go to Baltimore. Jimmy Seafood, what up? We know you. We love you. We want to go to Baltimore sometime this off-season.
Let's get to the question.
Let's get the question. Yeah.
Ready, lady.
Woman! my question is, can the Ravens finally stay healthy? It's that simple. And it's such an annoying question, and I hate to ask it, and there's no real answer I can give you right now, but that's kind of it, right? The last 2 years have been awful with that. And it's not just Lamar who's missed time. And Ravens fans it's not for Ravens fans. Ravens fans know this, okay? This is awful. Yeah, and Jackson missed 5 games. Dobbins, though, missed 9. Bateman missed the final 11. So we don't even know what is he? We need to know. Mark Andrews, we know he's great when he's out there, but he missed 2. He played hurt for a couple weeks in there, too. Ronnie Stanley, their left tackle, he missed 6 games. And Marcus Williams, their safety, missed 7 as well. And by the way, that's not including Odell, who, of course, missed all of last season with that ACL, and now he's on the team. And that's an injury from the Super Bowl. The Ravens team is loaded, objectively. I've given Eric DaCosta a lot of grief over the years, and he did exactly what they needed to do to upgrade the weapons around Lamar. But they have to be able to stay on the field this year for any of this to work out. And if the luck balances out and Baltimore does stay healthy, this is the most dangerous roster they've had in the Lamar Jackson era. And that makes it tough. And you're looking at, do the Bengals go back to the AFC Championship game with this roster staying healthy, looking like it is? It'll be so fun to watch. And they play each other week 2, which we talked about on our show after schedule release while all of you guys were talking about Aaron Rodgers up against Patrick Mahomes. They're sneaky play, this Ravens squad, over at FanDuel Sportsbook. They have the 5th best odds to win the AFC right now. The headlines have been dominated by last year's Big 3, and they should, I get that. And, of course, the Jets getting all of the headlines, the New York part of that, and Aaron Rodgers, of course, being attached to that. But I could see a full-strength Ravens team turning it over and turning this conference on its head. So nice little value play there if you want to have some fun. And finally, let's go to Pittsburgh and
steel
talk about
curtain question.
The Steelers. I was like, are you throwing something steel at me? That wouldn't be fun at all. Go ahead, Marissa Land. Just go for it.
You think I can?
Let's go. Oh, hey. Close. Eric, what do you got?
Let's get to it. Knock, knock. Who's there? Question.
That's a good one. I like that. My question, okay, let me look. Now I'm confused because I like your knock, knock question. Let me get to where I want to get to.
Stop stalling. Get to the question.
Stalling.
Can they keep their momentum going into 2023 was my question. Can they keep it going? I mean, you'd think the entire world forgot that the Steelers went 7-2 over the second half of the season. Like, when was the last time anybody talked about that? 7-2, okay? Look at the AFC North odds on FanDuel Sportsbook right now, okay? Hamilton dug this up. The Steelers aren't just the biggest long shot to win the division. The Browns have look at those odds, okay? Compare the Steelers to the Browns. Significantly better odds. So if I'm a Steelers fan, that's got me feeling some type of way. That is working on me. Have we learned nothing from the past 16 years, people? Last season should be the definitive proof that Mike Tomlin is never going to have a losing record. It's never going to happen. And with the way that Kenny Pickett and this young squad played down the stretch, why would anybody think that this team's just going to fall off the ledge and disappear in 2023? It's crazy. My last memory of the 2022 Steelers is courtesy of a mic'd up Coach Tomlin moment when he walked off the field following that crazy, dramatic Christmas Eve win over the Ravens. Remember this?
Yeah! We grew up tonight.
Honestly, I forgot about that bite. Hamilton was like, remember that? And I was like, oh my gosh, yes, we grew up tonight. And then I came on and I said, that's all that we wanted to see from them. Like, that was the goal. The goal was not even, and he wants to keep that playoff winning record thing, all that. But get together. That was the goal, and he achieved it that night on Christmas Eve. Tomlin's been around the block, okay? He knows what those type of moments can do for a young squad. Even in missing the playoffs, this team clearly matured as the season went on. And I don't think that can go under the radar or be underestimated. And I also want to take a quick moment to address what the Steelers did this offseason, because their moves didn't grab many headlines that I saw, but they did get better. The biggest concern about the Steelers going into the offseason was the O-line. And they rebuilt their left side. They drafted Broderick Jones from Georgia. They signed a stud. The guy from the Eagles. Yeah. They took the guy from the Eagles, and then my second biggest concern, guys, was the secondary. And they rebuilt it. They got Peterson in there. They draft Porter Jr. in the second round, which we love the story, but there's more to it than that. And then they got Neal from Tampa Bay. So A-Rob is there. He'll deepen the receiving core. That happened in a trade with the Rams as well. So I know this division will be tough, but make no mistake, the Steelers are going to be relevant. They always are. They're always relevant. How relevant? It all depends on how much they can build off that momentum that they built in that 7-2 stretch, down the stretch, last year. Don't forget about the Steelers. We're not here on the show. Kareem Jackson on the program. Never a Steeler. Longtime Texan. He's the star of KJAC Television. Everybody, he is here. What questions will we be asking him? Don't even think you're gonna ask me a question here, Kareem Jackson. Ream Boy, here, next.
I don't play by the rules.
Big dog, Kareem Jackson.
I'ma earn my respect, tell him write a check, put it in my name.
Big time hit by Jackson.
But I'm still in the game, cause I don't play by the rules.
Waiting to get Kareem Jackson on. We had him, we lost him, we're trying to get him back. I wish you saw that music video, it was so good. I love it, I love that he's back. So many years.
Yes.
Oh my goodness, he's been an NFL veteran for so many years. 9 seasons with Houston, 4 seasons with the Denver Broncos, and then of course he's back on a 1-year deal in Denver. I did ask Mr. Sean Payton why he signed him. What did he say? I think I told you, Brian, what did he say? Leader.
Great leader.
Like, that was like what he was harping on, and I was like, man, that's amazing. And like, young, feisty team, they want to turn it around. Hopefully we can get the most out of Russell in that offense so we can see what this defense can do. We are trying to get him. We also have Ron Funchess on the show, who's absolutely hilarious, and I'm just like, I know him. I'm going to, my mascara, it's all going to all come off because he is so, so fun. So we'll have him on the program as well because he has his Apple TV Plus series, Loot, and a new summer tour called Fun Voices as well. Chandler Parsons texted in.
He did.
Mm-hmm. Did you know it? Oh, no, I don't want you to know. You have to pick. No, I guess we can all pick the same person. It doesn't matter.
I already picked mine.
You already picked yours. Yeah. Okay, we're doing who's going to make the first basket tonight. Let us know. Hit us up on the old Up and Adam show. We're doing the music video again.
Re-rack, baby.
We're going to do this again?
Yeah.
What a ridiculous show.
I don't play by the rules.
Big dog, Kareem Jackson.
I'ma earn my respect, tell him write a check, put it in my name.
Big time hit by Jackson.
But I'm still in the game, cause I don't play by the rules.
We ran it back. Kareem Jackson is here entering his 75th year in the NFL. Kareem, hi.
Hey, how are you doing?
I'm so great. Listen, you know the TV biz. You know, I mean, you're Mr. KJAC TV, so sometimes there's technical issues, but we're here, we got this.
Definitely.
We're going to talk about Denver. You're back in Denver. I love to see that. Sean Payton says you're such a great leader. That's why he wants you there. You got a lot more to give on the field during this season as well to get the defense going. But let's talk a little NBA here because you were in attendance, my friend. We got to talk about this. Lakers Nuggets. You're with your Broncos teammate, PJ Locke, which we love to see. You made it on the TV broadcast, which we love. And you're cheering for who here?
Oh, I'm a huge LeBron fan. Cheering for the Lakers. I got a lot of love for the Nuggets. Obviously, being there the last 4 years, it would be 5 this year. Having a chance to watch those guys play and compete at a high level, Jokic, Jamal Murray, those guys have an excellent year. But I just have a great amount of respect for LeBron. He's my GOAT. I've been following his entire career. So I'm a huge LeBron fan. So obviously going to and watching him play, I went and watched him play the Lakers early, and he didn't play. So just having a chance to see him this year against the Nuggets, you know, I had to root for the Lakers.
I love it. Did you get any grief from Denver Nugget fans?
I didn't this time because I had just signed back. So a lot of the fans were telling me they were happy that I signed back. But if I were there, and I'm sure if I went tonight, I'm sure they'll be on my case tonight.
Well, they got your Lakers got to win tonight. They might not be mad at you because they feel bad for you because no one can stop Jokic. We had Chandler Parsons on the show yesterday, and I asked him, and he was kind of like, I don't know what you do to stop him.
Yeah, I think it's just one of those things. You got to expect him to get his. You know, he's a great player. You know, he's talking about a 2-time MVP. Could have been a 3rd time this year, but he's going to get his. You just can't let the supporting cast, you know, do what they did last game. Jamal Murray, I think he had 31. couple of the guys had like added like 15. I think Caldwell Pope had about 18 or 20 or something like that. You got to expect him to get his and do what he does because he's such a great player, but you just got to limit the rest of the guys.
14 NFL seasons for you. 14. Back in Denver, you love to see it. Did you think in this offseason when you had sort of your choice or you were trying to figure out what you want to do, were the Texans an option for you?
They weren't. They weren't an option. And I kind of figured they would be because obviously with them signing DeMeco, he brought Jimmy Ward from San Fran, and they have a young guy who's going into his second year who had a pretty good year last year, Petrie, who's probably going to be a great safety in this league. Between those two guys, I figured that they would set at that position. And if I did have a chance, it would probably be, you know, to probably back up one of those guys. You know, throughout the whole free agency process, you know, we had conversations with Denver early on, and they told us they wanted to sort some things out, which we kind of imagined they would want to do some things on the front line. And obviously understanding the business side of things, I understand, you know, you're an older guy. It usually happened a little bit later in free agency. But we've kind of was in conversations. We talked to them a lot, and they told us that, you know, they wanted me back. So just had to wait and, you know, till they get things figured out and, you know, and we visit my situation.
What made you want to come back to Denver? And what does that phone call look like from Sean Payton when he calls you and tells you he wants you back?
I've grown to love Denver. It's a great city. The fans there are like no other. You know, just having a chance to play in Mile High on Sundays, the atmosphere is ridiculous. Kind of reminds me of a college atmosphere, you know, but the fans there are great. And actually, I met with Sean, had a chance to meet with him in person, and we talked about a lot of things. Obviously, talked about the season, talked about what it would look like with me coming back, and that kind of sealed the deal for me. And, you know, the rest is history.
Where are you right now, Kareem?
I'm actually in Houston at the gym. I just finished a workout. So just trying to get things figured out over here and set up the right way so I wouldn't look crazy. But yeah, I'm actually still in the gym. I got a couple of extra sets left. So once I finish here, I'll finish up my workout and head off to grab some lunch.
I think that's the thing. I mean, we got to talk about this because you are currently the oldest, the most senior, I'll say, defensive back in the NFL. You are the oldest player going into the season in the AFC with no signs of slowing down, mind you. You had a career high in tackles last season with 94. What's the secret?
I would say my off-season regimen, you know, just kind of the things that we do here with my trainer. I think that's a huge part of my success and allowing me to stay healthy throughout the season, you know, on top of my my recovery that, you know, I put into play once the season kind of starts. But I think my off-season, my preparation and my training in the off-season, what takes me throughout the season and allows me to go out and compete at a high level at my age.
Kareem, shout out where you are. Shout out your staff. Shout out your trainers. I'll give them some love down there in H-Town.
Yeah, I try to every chance I get. His name is Ben. I'm here at Fairchild Sport Performance. He does a great job. I've been with him for about 5 or 6 years now. And, he does a great job.
Will you be playing or trying to play 20 years like your friend LeBron?
I don't think I'll be able to play 20. I don't think so. 20 years is a lot. I mean, obviously, him being able to play 20 is amazing.
Crazy.
You know, at the age 38, still not playing at a high level for him, that's amazing. But I don't think the game that we play, it'll allow me to play 20 years with my style of play at the position that I play. I've been fortunate enough to make it to 14. My goal was always to play 15. I'll see how I feel once I get to 15. And, you know, if I'm still able to go, I'll give it a run. But my goal is to play 15.
And you're almost there. It's very rare air. If somebody were to ask you, just come up to you on the street, like a young kid that plays youth football or flag football and say, man, that many years in the NFL, what is your biggest piece of advice or the biggest lesson that you learned in your career in the NFL?
I say for me, just learning from others. You know, when I was a young guy, obviously my rookie year, I was a young guy. I was fortunate enough to have guys like Andre Johnson, Glover Quinn, and then my second year, we got Jonathan Joseph, who played 15 years as well. Just learning from those guys, just picking their brains, just kind of coattailing them, you know, watching how they, you know, they prepare, how they took care of their bodies, you know, And that helped me a lot, you know, and I was able to pick up some tools and add to my toolbox, you know, along the way. So I would definitely say learning from others, you know, along the way, because even now I feel like I can still learn things and still, you know, implement things in the things that I do on a day-to-day basis that can help. So at a young age, I would definitely say find guys that's doing things the right way and just try to learn from them.
And when I'm hearing from you saying that, you're very aware that that's what the young kids on your team, the young cats that are coming up, are doing with you. And you're going to be there to impart that wisdom on them. And that's why part of the reason, outside of a career high in tackles with 94 last year, that Sean Payton wanted you back in the building. Now, I know a couple things about your coach. I think he's a little bit crazy. I think he's a control freak. I think he's got his hands on everything. He's like, you know, he wants to approve and make it the way he wants it. What has been the biggest difference so far, energy-wise or even like little things-wise, with him being in the building this year already?
Yeah, definitely. Definitely the energy is definitely different. You're talking about a guy that's won the big game, that's you know, coached at a high level, you know, you know, obviously running that New Orleans offense with Drew Brees and the things they were able to do on a year-to-year basis. You know, I feel like if you're a great coach in this league, you're going to have your hands in a little bit of everything that's going on in that building. You know, I mean, because he knows what it takes. You know, you're talking about a guy that has a vision. He knows how he wants to apply things. He knows, you know, how he wants his coach to go out and to execute things and obviously to echo, you know, what he's trying to teach. So I kind of love it. I'm used to that. I mean, obviously I went to Alabama with Coach Saban. He was another guy that was like that. You know, those guys are from that same tree, the Bill Parcells tree, you know, guys that, you know, has their hands in everything and kind of control freaks. But I mean, I respect it. And, you know, for me, like I say, I have no problem with adapting to that and being around that type of coaching style.
That kind. They're from that. Parcells is the way to put it. They are from that coaching tree. So we have big expectations for this team. You've got your thing going on defense. We had Patrick Surtain on last week. And Russell Wilson, very excited that you're back. He was tweeting about it. He's got, you know, you're in the building. We're excited. Talk to me about Sean Payton and his quarterback, and then what we can expect when you have a guy like Payton that comes from that's so invested. What can fair expectations be for Russell Wilson this year?
I think Russell have a great year this year. You know, having Coach Payton, you know, there with him. You're talking about guy that Coach Drew Brees, he that ran, you know, offense to perfection. So I think the same things that happened, you know, with us this year in Denver. I think Russell come back and he'll bounce back. He'll have a great year. He'll be, you know, obviously more efficient. You know, I mean, I think a lot of things, you know, kind of happened last year for us to have the type of year that we had. We had a ton of injuries. Obviously, having, you know, some guys back healthy, them rebuilding the offensive line definitely will help Russ as well. You know, I mean, getting Javonte back healthy this year definitely helped in the run game and things like that. They'll have a healthy Tim Patrick back, Cortland Sutton, Jerry Jeudy, all your weapons back. So now you can go out, you can perform at a high level, and you can run the offense more efficient. So I'll definitely look for those guys to have a huge year this year.
From this time last year, last one on Russell Wilson, but from this time, because you know him really well, and we want him to succeed, especially in that division. And you're talking about Sean Payton being a guy who's won the big game. Russell is that guy. Russell's a guy who's won the big game, lost a bigger game. He's a guy who plays through injury. He's durable. He's young still. From like this time last year, middle of May, when you started to get to know Russell a little bit better when he joins the team, till now, what's the biggest difference or evolution that you've seen with Russell?
And I'll start by saying I have a great amount of respect for Russ. I mean, obviously, it's a lot of different opinions out about Russ.
Yep.
You know, people questioning, you know, is he genuine? Is that really who he is? You know, I mean, Russ is who everybody sees. You know, he's a great guy. He's a great teammate. You know, he's a God-fearing man, and he's a family guy, you know, and when he's in the building, he's super positive. You know, he's a great leader. I think he's great for all our young guys that we have. I think he's a great quarterback, you know, and he's the guy, you know, for us to lead our offense. You know, I think it's a misconception, you know, about him just because of, you know, who he is and how he carries himself. But, you know, that's just who he is. You know, I think everybody in the building, you know, admires Russ and we love Russ. So, I mean, we look forward to him, you know, obviously leading us and being a part of a huge team and winning a lot of games this year.
We love to hear it, and I love that you just said that because I think that does exist, and the real ones know, as they always do. I have a question. Is KJAC TV coming back?
Definitely. I definitely look forward to doing that. For me, I enjoy it because it gives the fans a chance to see guys outside of, you know, being football players, get to see the real personality with these guys in the locker room that we see on a day-to-day basis, you know. And obviously, I think that's huge. I think, being able to show yourself outside of being a football player and for people to see it, you know, I think a lot of fans enjoy that. So, yeah, definitely. I mean, hopefully we win a lot of games so we can continue to do it week to week. It gets kind of hard when the season's not going the way we wanted to go. It's kind of hard to kind of shoot those things because we want to try to focus on, you know, getting our problems right on the field. So hopefully we're in the winning columns a lot and we're having a lot of success this year so we can have a ton of KJAC TV episodes.
I think you will. I think people are sleeping on the Broncos, but that's how I like it. I think everybody should and then pop up on the scene with all that pedigree.
Hopefully we can get you on KJAC TV.
My name's Kay, so I'm going to put you on KJAC TV right now and ask you a couple questions because you were having so much fun with that microphone, but here we go. What music would you choose to hear every time you walk into a room, like your walk-in music anywhere you go?
Walk-in music anywhere I go. I'll probably have to say I'm a huge Future fan, so I'll have to say Future.
there's a Russell Wilson thing there. What are we doing? You can't say that. Kareem.
I know I can't. You want me to be honest or you want me to lie to you?
No, I liked it, but then you gotta, I mean, I don't know. We'll just go through. I love you for that. You love everybody. That's Kareem Jackson's way. We're here for KJAC TV, everybody. The last teammate you talked to, and it's clearly not going to be Russell Wilson for the next couple weeks.
I love you, Russ. Last team I talked to had to be Justin. Talk to that guy on every other day.
All right. If you had to pick, let's say there's a world and you have to pick a roommate, or like you're going to NFL summer camp and you have to pick a team or pick somebody in the AFC West that's not on the Broncos, who are you picking?
Oh, wow. not on the Denver Broncos. I'll have to say I'll pick Bryce Callahan.
Why?
Obviously, we played with him a couple years. I know his personality. I'm pretty familiar with him. I kind of know what to expect, so I'll probably have to pick him as a roommate. It's kind of hard picking anybody else that I have a relationship with just because I haven't spent, you know, a ton of time with him. But I spend a lot of time with him in the locker room. I kind of know his personality and what type of guy he is, so I have to pick him.
Now, Sean Payton's close with Wayne Gretzky. He's close with Michael Jordan, as I'm sure he's told you 19 million times already. If you could pick one person to come in, if you could pick one person to come and address the team during training camp, famous person, celebrity, musician, Future, whoever, who would it be?
One person? Yeah. To me, it'd have to be LeBron. Just you talking about a guy that's been under the microscope since he's been 16, 17 years old. You're talking about from being a number one overall pick and having a ton of expectations, you know, placed on his shoulders to being drafted into, you know, his the team, you know, that he probably grew up loving. And from being from Akron, Ohio, to where he is now, you know, the championships, you know, the MVPs, you know, talking about a guy that really doesn't have a blemish on his resume, except for the decision, some would say. For me, he's my GOAT, so definitely it
have to
be
met
LeBron
him?
James. I met him one time.
Thank God. Okay.
Yeah, I met him one time. But for me, it'd have to be him. I mean, he's pretty much done it all, and you know, obviously he's a great businessman as well. So, you know, for me, it'd definitely have to be him.
Before we let you go, and yeah, it was great. That's KJAC TV coming to the Broncos Instagram, Twitter, everything, their website near you with Kareem Jackson. But before we let you go, I know your foundation is really near and dear to your heart. And earlier this offseason, you got to be the Grand Marshal of the Cherry Blossom Parade in your hometown in Georgia, which is amazing because you're on a float. It all benefit and honored the Kareem Jackson Foundation. It provides resources to women and children battling cancer. And I know that means a lot to you because I imagine you draw a lot of strength from your mom who beat cancer not once, but twice.
Yes, definitely. It definitely means a lot to me to be able to you know, honor them with my foundation, with the Kareem Jackson Foundation, my mom and my sister. And also my sister was a leukemia survivor as well. So that's why, you know, she's, it honors her as well. But for us, it's all about, you know, giving resources and just giving, you know, these families that's going through what we went through some type of stability and let them know that they're not alone. You know, there's people out there going through the same things that they're going through, and to bring everyone together and to support each other and to be there for one another. I mean, it goes a long way. So whenever, you know, we can do these things to help these women or help these kids battling this terrible disease, you know, we definitely want to jump at that opportunity.
And you do that with a Dinner for a Difference gala that you've done. You honor and you support women who are battling so courageously, and we appreciate you. If anybody wants information on that, KareemJacksonFoundation.org for that. We appreciate you. We're looking forward to it. Go kick some ass this year.
Yes, definitely. Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, good luck with Russell Wilson now. All right, we'll be back after this. Ron Funches, hilarious comedian, joining the show to promote Loot and wrestling? I don't know. What? Next guest is a comedian and actor who stars on the Apple TV Plus series Loot, which is going into its second season. Very excited about that. He's also about to embark on a new summer tour called Fun Voices. Ron Funches is here. How are you?
Hi, Kay. How are you doing?
I'm so good. I like your sweatshirt.
Thank you. It's so people know my name. It fits right underneath the bar.
Yes, it does. It does. I think maybe you need to go up a little bit because I think there's something below that bar.
Okay.
We gotta zoom out
above
on our friend
the bar.
Here. There we go. Listen, people. And our audience is really excited to have you in studio, and we even got a tip. Now tell me if this, because you know, there's rumors. This was on Dumont earlier. Let's take a look. Somebody said that in your coffee, put a Reese's.
Reese's cup in the coffee. I use that at Crest Service. I did, but that was like
that
when
was
I
no?
was, not anymore. That
okay,
was like
well,
when I was 360
it.
Pounds.
I'm going to try
so
it.
It was a thing I would do all the time.
But what do? You let it just melt on in there?
Let it melt.
Oh my God.
But this coffee's cold as ice.
Oh, it was a last minute problem. Okay, I'm going to try it. So it just melts and that's okay. We're going to see.
You're going to love it.
I'm going to love it.
You got a new addiction.
I can't taste it yet, but I'm excited for it to happen because my coffee's hot. How are we treating people around here? What's going on? Okay, so you're going to enter that tour life this year.
Yes, I got to. There's a writer's strike. I still got to pay my mortgage. So I got to get on the road, and I love doing comedy anyway, so why not?
How'd you name it Fun Voices?
Have you heard my voice yet?
Yes.
That's probably why. And I'm bringing my friend Blair Saki, who also has a tremendous fun voice, and it's just about bringing joy and fun and comedy and being different, and I just thought it was a fun name, and you can get these hoodies and sweaters and crewnecks there.
Amazing.
I'm gonna bring you one.
I want to go. So where are we touring? Where are we going?
Going a lot of places. Going back home to Chicago, going to Denver, going to Madison, Wisconsin, going to Bloomington, Indiana, which is the height of entertainment.
Listen, I used to work at the Comedy Club in Columbia, Missouri, mm-hmm. when I went to Mizzou, and it was always so fun to have these stars and comedians come by, and always great for laughs. So you guys can check out the summer tour. It's called Fun Voices, and get your tickets if you're there. But you mentioned Chicago. That's where you're from. That's mm-hmm. where you grew up. So let's get into that because you do like the Chicago Bears, yes? Even
I
though
do.
It's very hard.
Yeah, I'm not a traitor like you who likes the Bears. Just jumping on any train
wow.
that you see going by.
Oh, man, that's not true. I embrace them. What is it like being a Bears fan?
Horrible.
Yeah. Tell me a little more
it's
about
that.
It's
just knowing you're going 8-8, and then you're like, oh, wait, they added an extra game to the season, so maybe we're just always going to be losing, you know? But now there is hope because we have Justin Fields. We have a quarterback. We haven't had a quarterback in 20, 30 years.
23 years.
Oh, I love seeing him. Look at him go.
What do you mean? You didn't like Jay Cutler so much?
No,
yeah.
He seemed like a horrible leader and just like a guy who would be a bad manager at like a Sears. Like I would never want to work with him.
Yeah, I hear you do a good Stephen A. Smith impression.
I wouldn't call it good.
I would like to hear, since you know a lot about Chicago, Ryan Poles, the GM, he's mm-hmm. making really big moves here. Tell Chicago, who loves you, because you just killed me for the Bengals thing, and Chicago fans will love that you just said that. Tell me, you know, why our pain as Bears fans is finally over.
Okay, I can. I mean, it will be, again, horrible. Here we go, though. Chicago! Orange and blue skies, baby. They're not just for the Knicks. We're for the Bears. Because for the first time in a long time, we got rid of Pouty J. Cutler. We got rid of all the horrible QBs in the past, and now we're staying on the field. With Justin Fields, baby. We didn't trade him away to get a tiny little miniature version of a quarterback. We stayed strong and we surrounded him. We supported him like a good family or a good bra. And now he's going to just flourish for us. DJ Moore, we're going to get way more than 19 points a game. We're going to do way more than 8-8. We're going to the playoffs. That's a horrible impersonation.
That was great. I thought you were going to get a Tremaine Edmonds. They bolstered the deep. That was amazing. I'm literally crying. That was absolutely incredible, and I'm sure Stephen A. Smith will enjoy that. But he's busy with the finals in the NBA. So let's talk about your team, the Blazers, right?
I like the Blazers. I like the Bulls. I'm all about it.
Now, this Dame thing, though, we got to help Dame out. Now, you got a high lottery draft pick, apparently. I don't follow the NBA super closely. What do we need to do to help out Dame?
Let him go free.
You want to let him go?
Let him go.
Really?
I mean, I know he doesn't even really want to go, really. He seemed like he enjoys it in Portland. And you should. It's a great life. Most strip clubs in any city per capita.
What's the best one?
Casa Diablo.
Casa Diablo! Shout out! What's the best thing on the food menu at Casa Diablo?
It's all vegan there, so you can have healthy food.
A vegan strip club in Portland?
Of course.
Casa Diablo?
Yes.
Amazing.
I can't believe you've not heard.
No, I've left, but I love this. I love this whole show for this reason. I love this. Okay, so Dame, he went viral, apparently, for something he tweeted about LeBron? About King James?
Let's take a
look at this. Yeah, show me about it. Let's look. I was in seventh grade when they was hyping Bron on ESPN. MF, I don't know what that stands for. Still at the top 20.
My friend.
Yeah. Oh, my friend still at the top 20 years later. Stop playing with Jude Bra. It's getting out of pocket. Do you agree with Dame? Is LeBron getting too much disrespect this late in his career?
Oh, absolutely. But that's just because of how great he is. We judge him basically off of his past and what he's done before. But to see a player this old still playing, normally his whole entire draft class is retired, moved on, selling cars at used car lots, you know? Dwayne Wade hosting a TV show. Yeah. And he's still out there balling, putting up 20 points, getting rebounds, affecting the game. If you watch the game, you see he's out there truly commanding, oftentimes still being the number one or the number two best player on the team. And at that age, it is crazy. He should be like Robert Parrish, just sitting on the bench, just hanging out, knitting a sweater. But he's not. He's crushing it. And that is truly, we've never really seen, him and Tom Brady are anomalies. We haven't seen things like that before, so we should just truly just be in awe of it, really.
Be in awe of it. And you're saying this as a Chicago guy who should be saying LeBron and Michael, right?
Yeah, I hate LeBron as a as a player, of
but
course.
You respect it.
Yeah, you gotta respect him. Like, you know, I still go with Joakim Noah. He said mean things about LeBron, and I was like, yeah.
Noah says a lot of things. Maybe it's the vegan meals that, you know, LeBron opts for at places like Casa Diablo. They tell me in my ear that it's a 3.7 Yelp rating.
That seems high.
You think so? What's the highest rated? What is the highest rated strip club control room in Portland? Is it Casa Diablo or is that just a Funch's favorite? Which we should do Funch's favorites.
I love a Funch's favorite.
We love a Funch's favorite. Yeah. What's your Funch's favorite for LA? Maybe not strip clubs, but maybe if you feel like, what's your best place I need to go to in LA? I'm new.
Okay, if you're new here, okay, what do you, I don't know, I won't tell people where you live. Never mind. If you go to the Valley, oh, they have multiple locations. Go to Petit Trois, which is a wonderful French restaurant.
Okay.
They got a great location in the Valley if you want to be able to talk. But if you want to just like be a fun day, go to the Hollywood one. Major Domo, which is a great restaurant in LA. You got to order a beef rice place a day in advance if you want it.
Is that true?
Yes.
I have to plan my, that's what I hate about LA. You have to plan everything.
You don't like planning?
No, New York, Chicago, you walk out, you get whatever you want, you do whatever. But here you have to put, look, I have to plan a meal a day ahead.
Well, yeah, that's drug addict energy, just being spontaneous like that. I got kids, I gotta plan things out.
I don't taste the Reese's thing in here.
You gotta put another one in, stir it up.
This can't be true. You're a big shoe guy.
Yeah, I love shoes.
Okay, so recently you did something pretty amazing. You teamed up. This is insane. You have your own shoe?
I thank you.
It's so cool. And it's the RSX B-Seen. Tell me about that. Can we look
at it? Look at it.
Talk to me.
Look at that shoe.
How does this happen?
It's happened because basically I talk about things that happen in my life, I love in my life, and even things that sometimes think are obstacles. My son was diagnosed with autism when he was 2. I talk about it in my comedy. I talk about it in things I love. And now I've gotten to do great things like partner up with Foot Locker and Puma. All the proceeds for the shoe go to a great autism charity called Next for Autism, which helps find job placements. My son just turned 20, so that's big for me. I still want him to be able to work and thrive in this environment. So it's just a beautiful thing that, like, something when he was diagnosed when he was 2, it, like, you know, it was very earth-shattering for me. And now, you know, 18 years later, to see him thrive and to see him graduate high school and then now get my own shoe off of it with my name on it and to see him wearing it to school, it makes me so happy.
What's the response to that collaboration and that?
It's been beautiful. So many people supported me and, like, been promoting the shoe. My friends, like, I've known for years, like Conan O'Brien posted about it. Maya Rudolph on the show that I'm on, Loot, she posted about it, and it's been selling very well. So I've been very happy about it.
Perfect. And that's amazing. And we need those shoes. We need those shoes on set. I'd actually like them to be up here. I think those are super cool, and I love the colors. And they benefit such a great cause. Maya Rudolph, literally a girl crush of mine. Obsessed with her. She's amazing.
I know, I led you in with that segue. I wasn't going to mention it.
You did. It was really well done. I appreciate you.
But now, since you, let's go behind the scenes.
It's Loot. It's on Apple TV Plus. It was renewed last year for your second season, so congratulations on that. What's been the best part of collaborating with her and on, just really about working on that show? Take us behind the scenes.
Oh, I love working on that show. Just I'm more grateful the year I've been acting for about 10 years, been stand-up for 16 years, and when I got the first couple of things, I don't think I was as knowledgeable about how fun of a job it could be and how bad of a job it can be if you're working with horrible people who are not that fun or who just don't want to make things as funny as they can be. And working on this show is like working on like an all-star game of comedy. And I tell Maya all the time, I told her the first day that we did the table read, I was like, look, I'm going to be professional and just do regular work with you and have to treat you like a regular person. But first, I gotta just tell you I love you, I love your mom, I love Bridesmaids. I don't even know how far I'd be as a comedian if it wasn't for you, you know? And that, like, working for you is, like, to me, like, I get to work with someone like Lucille Ball, like, and that's an amazing accomplishment. She's a true icon in comedy.
Yeah.
And to watch her, the best things I've learned is just how much of a boss she is, because she's not just, you know, she's writing things on the show, she's acting in the show, and then she does the business aspect and producing and all that stuff. So she's choosing the billboards, and then, you know, when the strike happens, she's like, I'm not crossing the picket line. Like, it's a real, she's a real boss, and I learn a lot just from being around her.
And we're excited for the season of Loot, and that's so amazing. I feel like she must be happy to be around you.
She is.
You're very positive. You have really great energy.
I do, and I'm great to be around, and that's one of the best parts of the job. Sometimes, you know, you feel down. Sometimes you get people who online or whatever who don't know you or people in the middle, it always seems, that are always like, you suck. And it's like, you meet a legend, you meet like real people and they see something in you, it can really affect you. And so, like, we'll just be doing the scene. I will always remember, we were rehearsing a scene for this next season. And it was just me and her, rehearsal, not like anything we were shot. I just rehearsed the scene with her and I was walking away and she just goes, damn, you're good. And I was like, oh, that Maya Rudolph thinks I'm good at my job. Like, and it just, that always sticks with me when I go on the road and people are like, boo, you suck, you know?
Yeah, we hate those people.
Yeah!
Or we love them, but like, let them do their thing. That's an incredible compliment. That moment's gonna stay with you forever.
Oh, it always will.
Well, we love your energy. We're gonna keep you through the break here. We're gonna take a quick break. We wanna talk more, of course, about the Getting Better with Ron Funches podcast. We talk about acting and comedy and choosing to be positive. So we're gonna do that when we get back right here on Up and Adams with the hilarious Ron Funches. Go check out Fun Voices, the summer tour, and Loot! New summer tour alert, Fun Voices, Ron Funches is here, and you have an awesome podcast as well. So let's get to it, Getting Better with Ron Funches. And you talk to actors and comedians about staying motivated on what the, you know, that life is really like, working towards things you love. So I thought we could go through some things and call it Get Better with Ron Funches. things that I think that could get better, maybe the world could get better, and you can either agree or disagree with me. So, really? In-N-Out fries.
Oh, they can definitely get better. They suck. It's a horrible fry. It's like cold when you receive it.
Yeah, well, it's,
why are you whispering?
I don't know. Because your voice is, I just don't want to yell. Because I have like a yelling, I have a yelling, annoying voice.
So I'm agreeing with you.
Soldier Field
could definitely get, no, lettuce be.
Why?
Because it's supposed to be horrible. It's supposed to be part of our conditions. Maybe we do need a dome. You could help Justin Fields. No, still. You know, let him fuck. Let him bust his knee. What? I don't care.
Everyone swears on this show all day. No, we're not doing that. Okay, Postmates deliveries.
Postmates deliveries are perfect how they are. You don't think so?
I just feel like they're always wrong. They're missing, it's cold, it takes too long to cancel.
You're sitting at your house!
Yeah, that's true.
And someone just magically brings you the items.
I wanna be able to order one of your sweatshirts, your merch, and have mm-hmm. them drop it off. That's the world I wanna live in. Like, I want full outfits.
You just need to pop off and just come to you like that?
Yeah.
Okay, well, you seem very entitled.
It's fair. How about LAX Uber lines?
LAX Uber lines could certainly get better, but I don't think you stay in those, to be honest with you. I think you get a black car that picks you up and takes you to where you're going, because that's what I do, and I think you're doing at least similar or better to
me. What if I get an Uber black car, then is it okay? Like, it's a set, you know, just no?
At LAX, then you're wasting money. You might as well just gotten a regular black car.
Green rooms at comedy clubs.
Green rooms at comedy clubs can certainly get better.
How?
But by not, sometimes being horrible. Sometimes it's the stock room and you're next to the mustard and mayonnaise. And I'm like, that's not fair. I'm a human being.
Well, I wish you all the best green rooms at all the best comedy clubs around the country as you embark on your summer tour. It is called Fun Voices. Guys, everybody watch Loot with our friend Ron Funches and Maya Rudolph. Everybody, season 2 is here. We'll be back after this. And go Bears.
Yes!
All right, let's do it. We're doing first basket action tonight. We got the Nuggets, we got the Lakers. Jokic is the guy. Who you got? Quickly.
Jamal Murray.
Michael Porter Jr.
I'm with him. Michael Jordan Porter.
Michael Porter Jr. Yeah. Okay, Hamilton, who you got?
I'm going Anthony Davis.
Guess what? I got, that's what I'm doing too. I'm doubling down on AD. Take a look. Chandler Parsons, who's on fire. He's on fire. Oh. AD wins. Tip, AD scores first. Oh. Let's see, tonight on FanDuel Sportsbook.
A free throw.